tonight. So otherwise we're getting booted out. So okay, so move on. So the main event of the evening will be why the sky matters and how we lose it. But before that, just a couple of little bits of information. I'm Peter Black. I'm the vice president, or a vice president. The fellow vice president is sitting in the front row of the Astronomical Society of Edinburgh. And just a few things that are coming soon for us. So tonight we're doing the Why the Sky Matters, and Andy's here to do that. Jim Nisbet is doing the sky in April, and hopefully we'll have time for tea and coffee. Some of the things are coming up soon. We have our internal imaging observing group and secret light of stars, which sounds intriguing. An introduction to cosmology in the 21st century with the JWST. So by Gary Fields, is it Fields? And then the 8th of May again, imaging observing group. And then on the 17th of May, William Lasso, 1799 to 1880, telescopes, planets, and drinking beer. That sounds like something that we all should be doing. So looking forward to that. But tonight's main event is Andy Lawrence, Why the Sky Matters and How We Might Lose It. So Andy, I'll hand over to you. We'll see if we can find your presentation. This up for you. That is.
So what am I?
How do we make it into a presentation? You know? This isn't something I've used before. So.
No, well, you're asking me now, so I'll go ahead and put you down. Put a slate short. Do you copy or something?
Well, it isn't on this, that's the point. Mm-hmm. It's different. Present.
Okay. Whoop, now, is this doing anything? Can you hear me?
Yep.
Jolly good. Right. Let's clip on and off we go. Running on reserve. My laptop didn't want to speak to the ASC system, so run a PDF file on the official. Oh, I'll put that in my pocket. Okay. The sky, why it matters and how we might lose it. So some of this ASE members have heard before, and some of it you haven't, okay? The talk comes in two parts. Now, let me see, how do I advance slides here? Is it...
right hand, Aaron.
Oh, there we go, that's the one. Yeah, so this talk comes in two parts. Part one, is astronomy useless? Now, I hope you already have an opinion on that, but we need an informed opinion, which you can then share with your colleagues at home, in the pub, etc. Part two, the threat to the sky. So this is the part you've heard me talk about before, but we'll do a brief kind of up-to-date version of that. So let's get going on part one. Is astronomy useless? So I feel very lucky, privileged to be a working astronomer. I get to work on very beautiful and extremely fascinating things, galaxies, radio jets, etc. The universe is full of very strange and wonderful things. And I know in this audience, you obviously agree with that. You all love astronomy too, that's why you're here. But in a broader context, do we not have to admit that astronomy is fundamentally useless? I mean, it compares to big, important things like the economy, climate change, war, or even everyday things like how am I going to pay my mortgage, or how do I get my car fixed, or why are my kids so annoying, all those things. Isn't astronomy just really a kind of intellectual entertainment? Well, I think no, but let's try and see why. Okay, so I'm going to start in deep history and then come to the present. So firstly, historically, the study of the sky was absolutely crucial to humanity, to civilization. Reason number one, big reason, back deep in time, feeding ourselves. If you're going to know when to plant and when to sow, and how long it is before you need to do the next thing, then you need to understand the seasons, and to keep track, and to do that, you need to watch the sky. That's how it was done. Not just the sun and the moon, but the stars as well. So agriculture, that's the biggie deep in time. Number two, this will be more controversial to this audience, I think, divination. So now you will all be thinking this, most of my professional colleagues will be thinking, astrology, no, we know that's nonsense. Why are you talking about this, Andy? So that is what any sensible person thinks today. But historically, that's not the case. I see astrology as a kind of proto-science. It was, after all, it was about trying to spot the patterns in nature, in the cosmos, to understand them and move forwards, to use that knowledge to try and control and predict the world. That's exactly what science does. So really, I see astrology as a kind of proto-science, the one that we've now abandoned, but historically was absolutely crucial. So you know why those two pictures are there, of course, I'm sure. It was the Chinese court astronomers who saw the supernova in the Crab constellation of Cancer, a guest star, as it were. And we now know that was an exploding star, and that's the remaining shreds of it. But at the time, it was very disturbing and important. Next reason, navigation. So especially if you're out on the open ocean, if you want to know where you are on the surface of the globe or on your map in general, then you need to understand the stars and their patterns and how they change. So that, of course, is Alastair Bruce, many of you know, pretending to be Charles Piazzi Smythe with a sextant. So latitude, relatively easy. If you can spot the pole star and see what height it is, then you know your latitude. More generally, if you can't see the pole star, maybe some other stars. Longitude, a lot harder, of course, and for that, you need to couple that with accurate timekeeping, which is what Harrison and H4 and all that stuff was about. I say that, of course, but somehow the Polynesians did it anyway, which is quite interesting. That's a whole other talk that somebody else can give you. But in Western society, it was all about accurate time combined with measuring the stars accurately that gave us longitude. And talking of time, increasingly over history and the development of Western civilization, accurate timekeeping was absolutely crucial. It has become more and more the case. Catching trains, organizing meetings, just everything in civilization depends on knowing what the time is. Now, how do you know the time? Until quite recently, the only truly reliable clock was the turning of the sky. Of course, by the rotation of the Earth, but sitting here, it's about the turning of the sky. And that's why up until relatively recent in history, astronomers were employed by governments to, even when we had mechanical clocks, to watch the sky and synchronize the clocks to the turning of the sky and keep them well behaved. And that's why, of course, originally people in Edinburgh had to walk up Carlton Hill, stare through the window at the official clock and correct their timepieces. And then Piazzi Smythe came up with this brilliant stuff about the time ball and the 1 o'clock gun and all that, so you could correct your timepieces from afar. So, measurement of time. So that's all the big historical reasons, very, very big. And as I said, it's why governments were prepared to pay for astronomers. But you will say, okay, look, now we've got GPS, we've got atomic clocks, we don't need all that stuff. So, well done, astronomers, your time is gone. Not quite. So let's move into modern society. Now I'm going to start at the kind of fluffy end, and then gradually get more hard-nosed. Okay, so I think for many of us, it's important to have a sense of perspective, to get a feeling for where it is that you live. So there's a picture of planet Earth and the Sun, and you can fit about a million Earths inside the Sun. Okay, and there's a beautiful kind of illustration of that there, a model actually made by Stuart Lowe. He took lots of little polystyrene balls. There are a million polystyrene balls inside that large plastic sphere. So that gives you a sense of, you know, and we think it's a long way to the chemists, etc. So a sense of perspective. Broader than that, staring up at the night sky, looking at the nearest stars, I think even more, seeing the Milky Way. If you lie on your back and you see the Milky Way, that strip of light across the star, the sky, and then you just understand with a little bit of knowledge plus the observation, you think, this is because I live in a giant disk of stars. This is where I live. And you get this kind of sudden feeling that that is your home, that's where you live. So I think that's a very profound feeling and helps one's feeling of context in life. So just for a change, not an ASE picture, but a Caith Ness picture. Do you know Gordon Mackie? Take some fantastic pictures. Okay. That's not going to work in the PDF, that one. That was an animation of a little Milky Way survey with squillions of stars moving across. All right, next, still fluffy but important thing, inspiration. So there's your other honorary president, Catherine Haymans, our shiny new astronomer royal for Scotland. Yep. Okay, do you want me to just pause for a moment while you recover? So I'll do a little dance. Joe? Careful. Of course, this has to happen on the night that we all have to be out by 9:30. While he works on that, I'll tell you, I think you all know, I've got to collect Catherine's fleece, I believe. So I hope that's here. She's asked for it. Good, thank you. As you may know, Catherine and I live just around the corner from each other these days, but you don't see much of Catherine because of her long COVID, and she's still struggling. But great victory, as you all know, a project that... we're collaborating on, Catherine, myself, and the Society, is the smart scopes that we're taking up to the outdoor centres. So I've been testing those out in my back garden. It's great. I've almost turned into one of you folks. I'm like a proper amateur astronomer these days. It's great. And first time for 18 months that Catherine has left her house. She made it to my back garden, and we ran the Unistellar and the Sea Star together and took some pictures, and she was unspeakably excited, but then at the end of that very exhausted. Progress is of a kind is made. Okay, are we back online to watch? Should I just carry on, or do I wait, or what?
No, you need to tell a joke.
I need to... What about? I know this joke would work for professional astronomers. I don't know if it would work for amateurs. Do you know how to tell the difference between an astronomer and a physicist? You present them with a graph with a random scatter of points on it, okay? The physicist will draw a curve through the points, claiming that the model fits the data. The true astronomer will draw two vertical lines and label the diagram class 1, class 2, class 3. See, I knew Clive would like that. And there's John's at the back there thinking, yeah, I've done that. Yeah. I don't know, John.
100 want to change the bulb, and 99 complain that Brian Cox isn't really an astronomer.
Yeah, thank you. I'm stealing that one, thank you.
Is the laptop still got a display on it?
It had temporarily gone off, but I think, there we go. Oh, so they, oh, the people on YouTube have heard the jokes.
Brian Cox is so.
Yeah.
Maybe get some interesting comments.
Yeah. Brian, it was John Davis that said it, not me. Yeah, well, maybe, yes. Hello there, YouTube people. Yes, Zoom is frozen, so we're currently telling jokes. Anybody else got any astronomy jokes? There must be some more.
If any of you guys wanted to come down and use our telescopes, they're located in Cayley Gardens, just outside Peebles. We also meet, like you, once a month, and we broadcast our talks on Zoom, and if any of you would like to join one of those Zoom meetings, you'd be very welcome to do that, because I have discovered there are 5 astronomy clubs within 25 minutes' drive of Peebles. Yeah. And that doesn't make a huge amount of sense to me. So I'm interested in collaborating with other societies around the place to share speakers and stuff like that.
So now that I have converted to being a proper amateur astronomer, I know the right question to ask, John, is at the Tweedale, where that 24-inch is, what's the Bortle number? The Bortle, see?
It's about 5 or 4, I think.
Right, okay. Yes, and later on, John, we can convert that into magnitudes per square arc second, if you like. So how bright is the sky? My garden in Portobello is Bortle 6.
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, when it's dark in Cayley Gardens, it's really dark.
Yeah. Yes, this is a problem everywhere.
So we use a WhatsApp. One of our observing coordinators got a WhatsApp and he just sends a message out to everybody saying, we're on for tomorrow night, see you at 7:30.
Yeah. I like the fact that we've had a picture of Catherine being inspiring for about 7 minutes now. So I'll have to relay this information to her. Can I talk just as in rhubarb biscuit, umbrella, or anything meaningful? Oh, okay. I was. Do you remember there used to be a tradition between the observatory and the ASE of an annual quiz, the Pro-Am quiz, and the round that the amateurs always won, hands down, was asteroid or comet. So I was quite perturbed to listen to a student talk this morning, an MPhys project presentation, explaining that there are some objects that are a little bit in between active asteroids. Yeah, go for those. So they're asteroids, but they're outgassing for various reasons, temporarily. Very interesting. All right, shall I go?
We can resume.
Okay. Phew. All right, so next important, but still a bit fluffy, but very important thing, inspiration. So there's Catherine Haymans helping some children make glitter galaxies. And there's an excited young person in the visitor center playing with light. And as they get older, the thing is, astronomy is just applied physics. So we teach people physics, or even when we're teaching them astronomy, it's kind of like teaching them physics. We're pumping people through modern society. So that's what teaching training is all about. Right. So getting a little bit hard-nosed. Now, science and technology. Here's the thing that science and technology is a single kind of interacting web of things. It doesn't separate out. So, for instance, Newton, the law of gravity and mechanics and all that, how did he come up with that? It may or may not be true that he sat under an apple tree and watched an apple falling, but what we do know is that what he really wanted to do was to explain the motion of the moon. That was his goal in coming up with his grand theories, and nothing's been the same since. Moving forward to the 20th century, our entire modern world would be very different if it was not for atomic physics and quantum mechanics. Whether it's good things like electronics and how your phone works and so on, or more dubious things like nuclear bombs and so on. It's all about quantum mechanics. How did we come to understand quantum mechanics? What was driving people? Well, a number of things, but to quite a considerable degree, it was about trying to understand how the sun burned. And the spectra of stars as well, more generally. That's what was driving it. So what about the 21st century? Is that happening again now? Well, it's quite hard to tell because these things happen on a slow timescale. So it's quite hard to tell now what is going to be that transformative for society. But for instance, you know, our modern obsession with dark matter and dark energy could well be, and which we don't understand. By the time we do, that may transform physics enough that again there will be technological revolutions we simply cannot dream of, and it will be pushed by trying to understand how galaxies rotate. Okay, the economy. Now, you know that very expensive space missions and telescopes on the ground can cost millions, hundreds of millions, even billions of pounds or dollars. Now, does all that money, does it go to pay the salaries of people like me? And no, I'm afraid not. That would be nice, but no, nearly all of that money goes back out into industrial contracts. It's all about pumping money. This is why governments are prepared to do it, or one of them. It's about pumping money back into a modern, complicated technological economy. And it's not just money, we're important in other ways. Astronomy is a very demanding customer. Here's a picture of the grating on the X-ray mission Chandra, which, as some of you have heard, is at risk at the moment because of NASA budget cuts. It may have to close down, which would be a very bad idea. It's still working extremely well. But at some point, you know, I wasn't there at the scene, but some American X-ray astronomers will have gone to some company saying, well, look, we want a diffraction grating, you know, like diffraction gratings, yeah, but these have got to work in X-rays. So we want the rulings between the graters to be about 100 nanometers apart. There would have been a pause, and they would have said, you're joking, right? No, can you do it? Well, we'll give it a go. So that's so cartoonish, but that is kind of what happens, right? We're always pushing people, high-tech companies, to do better, to do apparently impossible things. Gravitational wave astronomy is another good example. To do that, you have to have, in space, to do it in space, you have to have, which is being planned now, hasn't happened yet, but it's being planned, you have to have spacecraft, signals bouncing between them, to control the distance between them to incredible precision. high-precision station keeping. But there are other people who might want such a perfect controlled station keeping of their satellites. So that will have an influence. So we push people. We're also famous for being early adopters. So astronomers didn't invent CCDs, but we were amongst the very first users of them to start taking pictures of the sky. Likewise, we didn't invent the World Wide Web. Particle physicists did that. But you know, one of the first few web pages was at the European Southern Observatory. But sometimes technology does actually spin outwards. So a good example is some of the components of technology that go into Wi-Fi were invented by radio astronomers, worried about the speed of connections of data transmission between their telescopes. An Edinburgh story is about data compression for large-scale surveys and those mathematical techniques that were developed for astronomy are now being deployed by Blackford Analysis for medical imaging. So again, you might ask, okay, that's great, but what next? And again, it's hard to guess. Here's what might be one of my guesses, kinetic inductance detectors. And I won't try and explain what they are now, but they're being developed for work in submillimeter astronomy. But it's such a novel technology, I wouldn't be surprised if they end up being useful elsewhere. Last but not least, planetary protection. Okay, so here's a fireball incoming. And we know from the craters that are on Earth that scary things do hit Earth. And if one of those hits Edinburgh, we're doomed. So it does happen. We'd like to know where they are. So the way you do that, again, another video here. And I hope it's even existence in my PDF file that's not destroyed. Zoom again. But traditional wide-field surveys today, how we look for near-Earth asteroids, killer rocks, something that might hit the Earth. By if you could see the video, you'll see that the object in the centre is slowly moving across the field of view. So you look for things that are moving that are extremely nearby. Okay, so that's the end of part one. This is trying to be useless. So I hope I've convinced you or supplied you with lots of reasons why that is not the case. Is everybody happy? Are we convinced that astronomy is in fact not useless? Yay. Right, good. That, I think seriously, it's important, you know, when you speak to your colleagues, your relatives, whatever. I mean, for all those reasons, it's not just that, yeah, I know it's not that important, but I love it. You know, it is important. It's embedded into the economy. It's about modern technological society, science, all those things. So just remember that. All right, okay, so now we agree that studying the sky is important. We need to turn to the problem we have, why it's under threat. So the biggest reason, to be honest, for most people is what I'm mostly not going to talk about tonight that we've had for decades, is simply light pollution. Okay, dark skies or the absence of them. So this picture here, this is a picture taken from Mount Wilson, which of course at the beginning of the 20th century was where a lot of the key advances in modern astronomy and cosmology happened. But it's now useless as an observing site. Those lights you see underneath, that's Los Angeles, which, you know, in 1910 was just a tiny little village. That's very different now. This picture actually shows a kind of double environmental catastrophe, as it were, because there's all those city lights which make astronomy possible from that historic site, but you can also see forest fires there, which are becoming more and more frequent because of climate change. All right, so bright skies, it's the reason why, of course, most ordinary people are, around industrial societies just kind of never see the stars, which is very sad. But what we're going to talk about today, as I'm sure you know if you've heard me go on about this before, is satellite photobombing. This is the new thing, streaks in the sky. And it's scarier in some ways because you can't escape it. So here we are, 2019, streaks started appearing across our images. And I'm sure you all know what they are. They're Starlink satellites reflecting light. And the next picture, Andrew can blush now because that's just to show that it's not just professional astronomy, amateur astronomy too. Amateur astronomers started going, what the hell's that? At about the same time. So I like that. But, well, I like that picture and I hate that picture at the same time, if you know what I mean. Thank you, Andrew. But ordinary people too. Well, if you do get to go to a clear sky, ordinary people are starting to notice and say to me, oh, is that a satellite? Oh, I've seen loads of satellites. And if you look up at the sky, seeing things crawling across the sky is much more common than it used to be already. And going to space is no escape, or at least in the traditional. JWST is okay, but HST is not. This is a Starlink satellite that passed quite close to the Hubble Space Telescope, made this incredibly bright stripe that obliterated a large fraction of the image. Now, satellite streaks aren't new. Here is a little bit of a Schmidt plate taken somewhere in the 1980s, and there is a satellite trail, that plate's in my office. There is a satellite trail. So, you know, it was happening. So what's the problem? Well, the problem is the rate of change. So now we're getting a bit kind of geeky and technical here. So here's a graph. So up the way we have the number of objects, and along the way we have time in years. So just for the moment, just look at the blue curve and ignore the others. So that's the number of working satellites, active satellites, and how that's increased over time. So it was always slowly increasing, but somewhere around about late 2019, it just went bananas, okay? And it's still going bananas ever since. The rate of change is just extraordinary. The gray curve in the middle is tracked debris, space junk, which is also increasing. By the way, we'll come back to that briefly in a moment. So that's the thing, it's the rate of change. It's not just how bad are things now, because they're already, you know, amateur astronomers like yourselves noticed this already, but where's it going to stop? It's, you know, how many are there going to be? Well, all sorts of people, other nations, other companies, it's not just SpaceX and Starlink. At the moment, they are the majority of the problem, but soon that won't be the case. You know, Kuiper, China, all sorts of other people are just getting in on the act, want their own constellation of satellites. It's getting very, very scary as everybody tries to compete. So it's a new space race. You know, some of them are much brighter than others. So this beast here, has anybody done an observation of a Blue Walker 3 satellite by any chance? They're incredibly bright. So you can see it's huge. So there's only a few of these at the moment. Eventually there'll be a few hundred, okay? But that sometimes is as bright as the brightest stars. It's first, second, third magnitude in the sky. So they can be very bright. Now, this is from the web page of an organization that professional astronomers quickly got together, the IAU Center for the Protection of the Sky. They've been tracking the number of proposals that are made. So that number in the center of the bottom row there, if you go to various licensing agencies around the world and look at proposals that people made, so this is not things that are definitely going to happen, but that number of 537,000 is the number of proposed satellites by various companies at the moment that are under review. Now, in 2018, there were 2,000 satellites. So soon there may be, you know, my guess is maybe out of that lot, there's probably going to be 100,000 by the end of the decade. So, you know, that kind of rate of change, and a big change, it's never happened before in any field without disaster. To give you a feeling for what that means, of course, no SpaceX are trying to say, well, we'll make them a bit fainter, maybe we can get them below, you know, visible. But imagine just looking up with a pair of binoculars, and without having to be a fancy astrophotographer, if you just lift up a pair of binoculars. So a few years ago, you might have stared with, you know, maybe a 7-degree field of view, right? You know, you could imagine you stare at the sky, it would be a couple of minutes before you saw a satellite. If that number of satellites happens, then by about 2029, 2030, you'll look up, there will be 10. And they will take 30 seconds to cross the field of view, and there will be another 10. So it's really very different. And of course, what we're really frightened of is the idea that we may end up with low orbit advertising. This is not just a scare tactic by people like me. This is actually a promotional picture by a company that was proposing to do exactly this, to make adverts that you couldn't escape in the sky, essentially. Now, that was turned down, and in most but not all countries around the world, there are regulations against that, but not all. And who knows where it might change. Meanwhile, and I wish I had more time to go on about this, but just so you'll remember, the associated junk is very scary. It can stop nice, sensible commercial activity happening in space at all by making certain orbits hard to use. But also that stuff is raining back down onto us. So here's a couple of things of large lumps that have landed on us. Something about as big as your thumbnail on the way down, if it crashed into a plane, would kill 300 people immediately. And, you know, it's quite possible. Just a few days ago, you probably saw this if you read The Guardian or the BBC News webpage, a piece of the International Space Station did actually land on someone's home in Florida. So these things do happen. Okay, so why is this happening? Why is everything going so crazy? Why so many? Okay, I'm a big fan of space, but thinking, is this crazy? All right, so it's about capturing the market, it's about national tensions, and it's about latency. So let's talk about that last one, because it's a bit techy, but very important. Latency is time delay. So if you look at that top picture, that represents a traditional communication satellite in geostationary orbit, going round the Earth at about 6 Earth radii up, 36,000 kilometres. So that's traditionally where communication satellites are. So the good thing about that is it can beam down to a large fraction of the Earth in one go. And the bad thing for some people is there's a time delay. If you send a signal up to that satellite and bounce it back down, you get a quarter of a second time delay. And you think, well, what's a quarter of a second between friends? We'll come to that in a second. So the new idea of things like the Starlink satellites and some others is to be in low Earth orbit, like 500 kilometers up. And to think about, that's not far. If you could drive up, you'd be there in a few hours. You know, it's like driving to Devon. It's really, really not much. They're quite close. But then that time delay signal is much, much shorter, a few milliseconds. But as you can see in that lower illustration, the disadvantage is then any one satellite can only see a small patch of ground in one go. So if you're going to have global coverage, you've got to have loads of the buggers, pardon my French. Right? You need to smother the Earth with a whole constellation, a network of these things, okay, to do that. Now, what's the business case for that? Why would you want that kind of very fast reaction? Now, of course, the PR that you hear is all about connecting the world up, you know, getting internet to poor Africans and so on. Well, I tell you, most of them couldn't afford a Starlink terminal. They will be supplying, internet to people in Utah who've Nebraska or something, right? Who don't have very good internet connection. That's a bit real, but at what price when you could be doing it another way? So it could be other things. For instance, high frequency trading. To send a signal bounce from one satellite to the other. At the speed of light, it's actually faster than going through a fiber optic cable under the sea. And in business, if you can shave off a few microseconds, you win. Okay, to do those automated deals, high frequency trading, to do it faster. So that's one reason. Another one is interactive gaming. So this is a very big market. You know, if you're playing League of Legends with a chum in California, and you raising your sword, and then you want to protect against it, and you need that to happen smoothly, not with quarter-second delays. Okay, so that's part of the mark. It's not about bandwidth. Remember, it's about real-time delay. That's the key thing. But finally, not often said out loud, but pretty obvious, is military purposes. Controlling drones in real time, for instance. So all those reasons are what's driving things, I think, and it drives the latency, and then it forces you into having lots of satellites. I don't think it's really about having lots of satellites to give internet to everybody, because to do that, you'd need 500 million. You just don't have the bandwidth. So that's what it's really about, I think, those things. All right, so those, getting back to the two types of astronomical pollution, the difference between light pollution and this new kind of optical interference as well. Oh, by the way, I'd say from the professional point of view, for radio astronomy, it's much worse than for optical. For optical astronomy at the moment, it's annoying, and it could get very annoying. For radio astronomy, it has the potential to be really, really bad. There we go. So the difference between this, although light pollution is really, frankly, much worse in many ways, at least it's local. This may not help many of you, but you know, for us professionals, at least we think, all right, we'll build it on some remote mountain in Chile somewhere, get away from all the lights. At least that is a choice. This new type of interference, there's no escape. You know, you launch some satellites from California, an hour later they're flying over France. Nobody asked the French. They're just flying over. You'll all know that that led me to write this popular book. If anybody hasn't got one already, I do have some here. And you can get it. Any purchases tonight, I'm saying this in front of Clive, will go to the ROE Trust. But I know probably most of you got it, or you can get it online. But it's there if you want it. Basically, having convinced you that the sky does matter, but we do have problems, I'm going to stop there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Andy. Thought provoking as usual. So, questions? Anybody in the room, first of all, got questions?
I'm just curious if you've worked out roughly how many satellites you can actually get in low Earth orbit before it's actually saturated. I don't have a feel for what that number is.
That's quite a tricky question, and one that people are trying to work on now. And the number of satellites themselves. Well, firstly, it depends. If you could spread uniformly, that would be one thing. But the satellites tend to be placed in quite thin orbital shells, so the danger is that one particular shell gets quite crowded. Now, in terms of the satellites themselves crashing into each other, it should be okay. You can get quite a few in, but the problem is the debris that's gradually caused, and then certain orbital shells could get dangerous to be in because of all the small fragments. So a lot of people in industry and in government are worried about that problem, but I think it tends to be a little bit overestimated, that problem. I think the real problem is the same as we have, is the integrated sort of busyness of the sky at any distance looking up through it. And obviously that's what we're worried about as astronomers, but some companies are also worried because the satellites trying to speak to ground stations on the Earth interfere with each other. So in geostationary orbit, there's already a limit. You can't have satellites closer than a degree apart on the sky, right, for this reason. And that issue will start to hit us in low Earth orbit quite soon as well. So I think that's going to be the biggest problem. There are other problems, like if you just have too many and you keep deorbiting them, you're dumping pollution into the atmosphere. There's all sorts of possible problems. But all these things are quite hard to calculate. So it's a good question to which there isn't yet a clear answer. People talk about carrying capacity, which personally I think is not a very good name, but I won't bore you with why. But trying to get at exactly what your question is asking. When are we full? But we haven't yet settled on a good measure of what we mean by full.
Any more questions in the room?
Do you think there will be a scheme to collect the debris, and if there might be legislation of, like, if you want to send a satellite up, you have to collect 10 pieces of debris down first or something?
There are already companies who are planning to try and make a business out of that, to say, not so much collecting debris that's already there, which is quite hard, but to say, we'll help you avoid making debris. When your satellite's finished its life, we'll go and fetch it down for you. Okay. So there's a kind of commercial solution trying to build up on that, and that may or may not work, and it doesn't collect the stuff that's already there. But also, I think that only really works if you really bring things back whole and reuse them. If you just bring them down, as this is what tends to happen at the moment, people believe they got better at controlling debris by, at the end of life, either putting things up a bit into a graveyard orbit or bring it down to the edge of the atmosphere and let it burn up. But as we do that, we're causing a lot of problems with the stuff that's coming back down, and people are only just starting to understand that. But people have been studying the technology of how maybe you can collect things, but certainly how you can try to dispose of your dead satellites responsibly. That is something people are working on.
Another question?
Is there any international regulation about permitting people to put up satellites, or can anybody do anything?
My commercial chance would tell you there's too much regulation. Every country has some sort of licensing authority. But their priority mostly is about encouraging commercial activity. Some of those agencies around the world are just starting to kind of realise that people are getting a bit worried about things. The laws, there's a big thing, international thing called the International Space Treaty, but which is very vague and general. And mostly it's down to each country at a time, and you apply to somewhere and ask for permission to launch. The problem, though, is actually nothing people wear, it's flags of convenience. If the US finally starts to say, we're a bit worried about this, we're going to say no, the Federal Communications Commission is the agency in the US that does this, then there's already the biggest of that 537,000, the biggest project planned is in Rwanda. So, they're just hoping for kind of nice, easy permission. So getting all that to be agreed internationally is quite hard, because it's one country at a time.
Okay, anything on Zoom? YouTube? No. Okay, well, can we thank Andy again for coming? And now we're going to move on to Jim for the sky in the next month. It does.
Okay, I think we're set. Let's hope we don't have any further problems this evening. Sorry we did have an interruption. So my turn again to guide you through the sky this month. Although, as I've said before, I think there's an element of imposter syndrome here, given that most of you in the audience probably know much more about this than I do. But here we go. I do always like to refer to Alan Pickup's excellent Scotsman column. So I might be the only person who still actually reads it in the paper, but it's well worth getting, actually, and Mark's good offices and the Scotsman's Agreement. We do have it on our society website where it can be referred to all month. So we'll start with usual thing about times of sunset, etc., and sunrise. And we can see that there's quite a change as we go through the month. And what you will notice, of course, is that we'll soon be at the stage where there's not really any astronomical darkness at all, which means summer is on its way. I'll start, actually, you'll see I've put in tonight's times, middle of the month and end of the month. The eagle-eyed amongst you may have spotted why I've selected 8th of April as an also date for having some times, as the solar eclipse, which is happening on that date, is gathering headlines and interest around the world. It's often been described as the Great American Eclipse, with the path of totality heading northeast from Mexico. It's covering, you know, it's going to run through a few major North American cities like San Antonio, Dallas, Indianapolis, Cleveland, Buffalo, Montreal. So there's probably quite a large population is going to be visible, able to see it. And someone I know is considering a trip from West Virginia for 10 hours to go to southern Ohio. Although I did comment to her that should be a lot of other people who have the same idea. So totality lasts anything from around a minute up to 4.5 minutes. And they'll be sort of, it's not quite at the maximum somebody could see of just around 7. But hopefully people will get a chance to experience that. It's always worth reminding people when talking about the sun that never to look directly at it or point any unprotected instruments in its direction. You may also be aware that there is the slight possibility that the partial eclipse could be visible from Scotland, although, as you'll see from the times, it's pretty much just at sunset, so you'd need to have a very sort of clear view to the horizon. Before you get too excited, the current weather forecast for Edinburgh and Glasgow is not looking terribly hopeful, even if you could see to the horizon. But whilst we're speaking of the sun, I just thought I'd be highlighting a couple of images that ASE members have posted recently, which is recording sunspot activity. We'll turn to the moon, and so we're approaching a new moon on Monday, which thought, that's a song. I don't know if anyone has a sort of trivia question, knows what the song is. No, there's no Duran Duran aficionados in the audience tonight. The April full moon is known as the pink moon to native North Americans, apparently named after a type of wildflower in bloom. Various other cultures describe it as an egg moon, a fish moon, sprouting grass moon. I think there's obviously a sort of vibe about things growing, renewing at this time of year. And for anybody who wants to explore a bit more about the moon, the ASE website has images from members for 100 lunar objects, which is worth having a look at. We'll move on to the planets, although, and I think it's been getting worse every meeting we've had about what planets are visible, with this month really only Jupiter being possible to see in the evening, fairly low in the west, but getting lower in the hours after sunset. So it will be possible to see it, but it, you know, you have to get your timing right. And any of the other planets, they're either going to be just setting as the sun or rising as the sun, it's going to make them very difficult to see this month. There is a comet in the sky at the moment, I've included this picture from the ASE Flickr group by Ramsey McIver. Magnitude may just get to the naked eye visibility. I don't know if anyone has seen it here. It's on the star chart a bit later on, so we'll see more about where it actually is. And speaking of comets, you may have seen that Mark posted something on the Society website that the Acero images had spotted an outburst on comet 29P Schwassmann-Bachmann 1. Although it does need to be Acero or something else, given its 17th magnitude. But if you can see it, it's between the constellations of Cancer and Gemini. So turning to the sky, actually, Graham, can we have the lights down a bit in this one? Because that probably. Vega is visible low in the north. I've put magnitude zero-ish. It's the star which is probably closest to what a reference 0.0 magnitude would be. And you can see in the west-northwest the position of comet 12P Pons Brooks. And actually the constellation Andromeda, where it's close to, which is low in the sky, we'll all be familiar that it's home to the Andromeda galaxy, Messier 31, magnitude 3.4, and always described as the object you can see the furthest with the naked eye, which is always a good excuse to get a sort of image from the ASE Flickr group from Peter Jackson. And so, looking east now, so prominent almost due east at this time, which is in about an hour and a bit tonight, although those of you who've struggled here this evening will know that there's probably not much chance of seeing anything in the sky tonight. The best hope we can have, I think, is it might stop raining. And so we would have been able to see Arcturus. Just looking towards the southeast from Arcturus, we see Virgo, and that area of sky between Virgo and Leo, home to the Virgo cluster, which Alan mentioned in his column this month. 1,300 galaxies, even up to 2,000, a cluster 54 million light years away. And again, we've had a couple of imagers from the Society pointing their cameras and telescopes in that direction, and have had some great images to show us there. Next up, if we look south, we'll see, I think, one of the most recognisable constellations in Leo, which I always think is one of the ones that looks actually a little bit like the thing it's supposed to resemble, unlike most of them, I think. And if you sort of look at where the Milky Way is through the sky, you can see quite a number of sort of bright stars visible, whether it's from Sirius up through Procyon, and then Betelgeuse and Rigel in Orion, and then Castor and Pollux in Gemini, and then up to Capella. All of those have places, you know, place them quite high up in the league table of brightest stars in the night sky, and are visible, if we had a clear sky tonight. Sirius also appears in this chart for looking west, where Orion still spectacular, although getting lower, and a sign that the winter is coming to an end, as it sort of drops out of our sort of sky. And you can see here where we would look for Jupiter at this time. It has a conjunction with the moon, but 2 days beyond new moon on the evening of 10th April. Looking in mentioning Orion, we had a super picture of the Orion Nebula, also posted to the ASE Flickr group. The group is itself linked from the ASE website, and just in case anyone doesn't know, it's publicly open, so everyone can sort of appreciate the great photos that the members have been taking. With that, I will sort of conclude this brief whistle stop tour, and hopefully that still will leave us a bit of time for some tea and biscuits before chucking out time later. Thank you.
Thanks, Jim. Well, thanks again to Jim and to Andy for entertaining us, and to the technology for entertaining us as well for a while earlier on. But that's it for tonight, apart from the tea and coffee and the dancing.